Come one, come all. To the show where former football stars tell their stories. Plus the 12th Man segment with Sports One Marketing. It's all right here, right now, on Thursday Night Tailgate. With your hosts, Chris Mascaro and Bob Lazzari. Guys, take it away.
Hey, thank you, Joe Lajanusa. Good evening, everybody, and thank you for joining us tonight on Thursday Night Tailgate. We hope the arrow is pointing up for you on your week, and we can't thank you enough for being a part of the show. Hopefully, we can make the next 2 hours really enjoyable for you. I'm your host, Chris Mascaro, and tonight my co-host, Bob Lazzari, and I have some really great guests that we're looking forward to sharing with you. We're going to start things off this week, just like we do every week, on our 12th Man segment with Sports One Marketing CEO David Meltzer. And tonight, his special guest is NFL sideline reporter Michelle Tafoya. Michelle tried to join us a few weeks ago, just unfortunately couldn't get a good sell from inside the stadium before kickoff. So we look forward to having her as part of the show here in just a few minutes. Then we're going to take a look around the league to week 7 in the NFL with former Patriots Pro Bowl running back Tony Collins and our 5-star picks of the week. Tony and I were fortunate. We gained a little ground on Bob after last week, so we've still got some hope. So we look forward to catching up with Tony here about 25 minutes from now. Also joining us tonight is going to be Leslie Court from Gridiron Now. We're excited to have Leslie back with us on the show. She joined us a few years ago in our Girls Night Out episode. So looking forward to having Leslie back on the show. One of our favorites, former Chiefs and Jets Pro Bowl kicker and should be Hall of Famer, by the way, Nick Lowry is also going to be back with us. It's always so much fun getting to spend some time with Nick. And then we're going to round out tonight's show with Lions Hall of Fame defensive back Lem Barney. So always very exciting when we get the opportunity to have a Hall of Famer on the show. We look forward to catching up with Lem at the halfway point of next hour. So we've got another great night in store for you. So sit back, relax. Let us take your mind off everything else going on in your life for the next couple of hours. But, you know, there's never a better way to kick off a show than bringing in my co-host, Mr. Bob Lazzari. Bob, how are you tonight, my friend?
Good evening, Chris. How are you?
Fantastic. You know, we were talking a little bit off air, you know, nice day, nice weather here. But it's always so crazy what goes on up in New England, you know, nice and cold and nice, crazy stuff.
We were in the 20s on the past weekend, Chris, at night. We were into the 20s. Probably Sunday morning. Wind chills during the day were in the 20s. And today it was 70. Tomorrow's supposed to be 75. And as I've told you off the air, everyone and their brother is sick up here. So that just goes with the territory. But I never saw it this early in October. And the acorns and the leaves are on the ground, Chris. We had such a dry summer. The foliage, you've seen pictures. It's beautiful. But leaves and acorns are all over the place, and they're actually they're just in the way. And you know, doing some exercising outside, and it's crazy that you have to watch falling acorns and acorns that are on the ground in order to get a workout in. But that's New England. It's nuts up here. Pardon the pun.
Literally. Yeah. Good to be a squirrel in New England about now.
A lot of those on the roads, Chris. Yeah.
So, Bob, you, me, and Tony, we all thought the Patriots were going to give us a huge blowout over the Colts on Sunday night, and that blowout didn't happen. The Pats did get the win. I was curious to get your thoughts on what you saw out of both teams Sunday night.
Got the feeling, and I give Belichick respect. He didn't have the feeling, Chris, that he really wanted to run up the score or make a statement or anything like that. He kind of just followed his game plan, wanted to win the game. You know, I think if you really get too tanked up and everything, however good you are, you can take guys out of their ultimate goal. And I think they just did enough to win. I didn't think they played their best, but I think it was totally overrated. I think these guys go into every game just wanting to win. If you can win a road game, Chris, in the NFL, it's always a good thing.
Yeah, no doubt about that. Now, I'm curious also, Bob, what did you make of that ridiculous fake punt? I mean, have you ever seen anything like that?
No, the formation was insane. The snap was not supposed to happen. I looked at Chuck Pagano's face at the time, Chris. I don't know what he was thinking. He looked shocked, but I was shocked that it was just lined up that way. I have been asked on other shows about it. I don't know why it was attempted. Never saw a formation like that. It was just so bizarre that I've tried to put many scenarios on why it happened. I can't come up with one. How about yourself?
I've never seen anything like that. You know, and then I think it shocked, just like you mentioned, you know, that they actually snapped the ball. I wasn't sure what they were going for there. If that was, you know, just, you know, trying to get some confusion. You know, obviously listened and watched, you know, Pagano talking about, you know, maybe he would catch them with too many men on the field, that they would be, you know, really confused. But even it was an illegal formation to begin with. So, you know, regardless of what had happened, you know, they didn't even, you know, they get any part of that thing right. But yeah, that's one of the nuttiest things, Bob, I've ever seen.
Yeah. And shame on the coaching staff too, Chris. Like you said, an illegal formation, and the guys were just very undisciplined. We're seeing so much of that. We just had another game the other night, Chris, with 21 penalties, the Giants. Eagles right. have been in two of the ugliest games this year, of course. And we'll talk about it later, but it's actually tough to watch some of these games. When you have 10 to 12 penalties, Chris, it's tough. We've seen a couple over 20. I mean, this is getting really bad.
Mm-hmm. And speaking of the, you know, the Giants, Bob, that's a team I simply can't figure them out. Just when I think, you know, they sort of settled down and settled into the season and could go on a nice run, take control of the NFC East, they lay an egg like they did Monday night against the Eagles. I mean, I'm not sure what to make of, you know, of either team, because as bad as the Eagles have looked some, you know, some weeks, particularly the first couple of weeks of the season, they certainly looked, you know, an awful lot better. To your point, very undisciplined. The flags are going crazy. But, you know, and the Giants, you know, the other way, just, you know, they started out the season, could have arguably been, Bob, going into the Monday night 5-0, because the first couple of weeks they barely lost and probably should have won. And then they come out, you know, after looking so good the week before, they look terrible Monday night.
Yeah, this is what drives you crazy. And the people around here, a lot of Giant fans, Chris, up here in New England, a lot of them. And, of course, I went to school in New York and is still in contact with a lot of those people. They cannot figure him out. And Manning, as good as he is, as how much he gets paid, and, you know, for the Super Bowls, et cetera, Chris, he still has games with that deer in the headlights mentality, which people can't figure out. I got caught picking them against. I thought they'd go down there and continue building on what they had, a little momentum.
Right.
In today's papers, it's all about we're not going to play that bad again this year. I mean, do we truly believe that? So that's the Giants in a nutshell, though. You know, whether you have Victor Cruz or not, it's all about Manning. He has those games, and he looks like he did 10 years ago, where you'll see him and you shake your head and you know, they're saying, you paid all this money to this guy? And then the next week he'll go out and get 40 completions, so... You don't know. I'm just glad we don't have a Giant game to pick this week.
Right. Not done on purpose. I promise you that. Yeah, Eli, 24 passes, only 189 yards on Monday night. Not that Bradford was that good either, Bob. Three interceptions that he threw. Now, if you're an Eagles fan, the upside is there was actually a DeMarco Murray sighting. He got his first 100-yard rushing game as an Eagle. So at least the Eagles fans got a win, and they saw DeMarco Murray actually have a good game. So, yeah, which way the arrow was pointing on either one of these teams, it's a crapshoot at this point. But
yep.
You know, we'll see
as the season rolls on. We've said about that division all year, right, Chris? That division is just it's going to be ugly. That's what we do know about it.
That's right. And we'll get into more of that when Tony Collins joins us later this half hour for our five-star picks of the week. All right, folks, we want to get the ball rolling here on Thursday Night Tailgate like we do every week by sending out a big thank you to our military personnel listening in to us tonight around the world on the Armed Forces Radio Network. We also want all of our veterans and everyone currently serving in every branch of the military and public service to know how much we appreciate all of you. Thank you for the sacrifices that you and your families made as veterans or are making now for every one of us. We sincerely appreciate what you do to protect our freedoms and our liberties that allows the rest of us to do what we do. Big thanks as well goes out to Sean Cruz and all the wonderful folks over at the Armed Forces Radio Network. It's an honor for us to have Thursday Night Tailgate as a part of your network. You can find us by going to armedforcesradionetwork.org. Also want to remind our veterans, like we do every week as well, to check out globalvoiceforveterans.org, a great site with a wealth of information specifically geared towards our veterans. On there, you're going to find news and articles that are both interesting and beneficial for you. Again, check it out, globalvoiceforveterans.org. TNT is brought to you, you know, this and every week by the great folks over at Kyven Foods, owned and operated by our good friend and former Falcons and Bengals tight end and now TNT Hall of Famer, Reggie Kelly. For the best salsa on the planet, folks, you have got to try Kyven's honey apple salsa made with premium honey and apples and perfectly blended with cilantro and peppers. Sold in various Walmarts throughout the Southeast and Ohio. For recipes, locations, and online orders, check out their website at kyven82.com. And Kyven is K-Y-V-A-N. And if your local Walmart doesn't carry the honey apple salsa, well, request it. They're going to be happy to add it to their shelves for you. TNT is also sponsored by Dr. Peter Candelora and the great folks over at Coastal Orthopedics. Folks, if it hurts when you get out of bed in the morning or you are just simply tired of dealing with joint pain, stop. Do what the Gridiron Greats do to get relief, and that's contact Coastal Orthopedics. For more information, check them out online at bone-dr.com. Major League Baseball, midway through the postseason now. They've got some great things going on over at the Louisville Slugger Museum and Factory for you. If you love baseball, do yourself and your family a favor and go check it out. If you haven't been, folks, I keep telling you, you really got to go. They've got some great exhibits going on there right now from our friends over at Topps. Plus, they're honoring the Big Red Machine there through the end of the month. Plus, you get to walk their live production line and see, you know, the full bat, you know, manufacturing process going on there right in front of you. It's so fantastic to check it out. I mean, it's amazing to watch the bats. I mean, the way they cut them out and, you know, go through the production line, that stuff is awesome. To find out more information, to book your visit, go to sluggermuseum.com. We also want to give a shout out to our friends over at the Gridiron Greats organization. Those folks are doing such great things to help take care of the guys that played long before there were six-figure salaries or health care coverage. Please help us help the guys who literally left so much of themselves out on the field. Remember, folks, these are the guys that played way back when they still had to get an off-season job just to support themselves and their families. They played before there was free agency. And like I say, six-figure salaries. Heck, before there were seven or eight, you know, figure salaries that guys are making now. It's an organization like this one that Mike Ditka started, the Gridiron Greats, who are there trying to help these guys we all grew up watching and reading about. Please go to gridirongreats.org to see what you can do to get involved. All right, before we get to our 12th man segment with David Meltzer, let's hear from Joe Lajanusa about our friends over at Kyven Foods. Like I say, brought to you by former Bengals and Falcons tight end, Reggie Kelly.
Add great flavor to your next tailgate party with Kyven Salsas. Former NFL tight end Reggie Kelly created these salsas for dipping chips and much more. In hot and mild flavors, Kyven salsas make a great marinade. They are terrific in meatloaf and are super toppers for everything from baked potatoes to scrambled eggs. It's a great ingredient to enjoy in a variety of family favorite meals. And some people say Kyven salsa is a meal to itself. With all the possibilities, Kyven is truly salsa with soul. Kyven salsas are also made from natural ingredients, and they are preservative-free. So look for Kyven, that's K-Y-V-A-N, at area Walmart stores or online. Click on the Kyven logo on our website to check retail and online locations. More information at Kyven82.com.
Yeah, if you want to knock your friend's socks off at your next house party, your next tailgate party, or any of your upcoming holiday parties, be sure to serve them plenty of Kyven Foods, salsas, sauces, and spices to liven up everything you're going to put out on your spread. Be sure to check out their recipes. You can find them on our site, ThursdayNightTailgate.com, as well as their own site, Kyven82.com. And again, Kyven is K-Y-V-A-N, the number 82.com. And give them a like on Facebook. That's important to them, too. Folks, I'm telling you, one taste. And you're going to appreciate the goodness. All right, now joining us on the Kyven Foods guest line on our weekly 12th man segment is Sports One Marketing CEO and best-selling author and our good friend and TNT Hall of Famer, David Meltzer. And a special guest tonight is NFL sideline reporter Michelle Tafoya. David, how you doing tonight, my friend?
I'm doing terrific. How are you guys doing?
We're fantastic. Better now that you're here.
Yeah, right on, vice versa. Well, I'm just terribly excited about tonight because this special guest of mine brings back so many great memories and one not so great memory, actually. So I, you know, remember from early on the Olympics with Michelle, to the NCAA basketball stuff on CBS, to, you know, our first sideline reporting and ESPN and Monday Night Football, ABC, ESPN again, her own drive show in the afternoons, and now, of course, on Sunday Night Football as a sideline reporter again, bringing back memories because she's from L.A., just like Lee, and went to Berkeley. So my old partner, Lee Steinberg, and she is definitely an innovator like Lee, who started Sports Agentry. She was really one of the first unbelievable sideline reporters and countdown reporters that I know. And she's still incredibly carrying the torch. And there's so many great issues. You know, I sit on the board of Just Capital with Deepak Chopra and Paul Tudor Jones, and we were discussing equality and equality by gender and pay. And, you know, it takes people like Michelle to create these opportunities for everyone. And we wouldn't be where we're at without people like Michelle. But before I bring her on, I do have to share one bad memory that Michelle brings up for me. And that's my high school dating career, because my team screwed up our last booking. And I felt like I was going to the prom, stood up. And I wanted to apologize to Michelle. So,
no need to apologize.
A hurtful memory. I'm just so excited that it was my team screw up, and you didn't turn me down like my wife, who I went to high school with, who I finally got to marry me. So thank you.
You bet.
Well, Michelle, I want to start off. You know, obviously, I'm a big fan, but tell me where you see the evolution in sports and women, because I think, you know, the equality is coming. It's not quite there, but I'm sure you've seen the progress. And I was hoping you could give our listeners some insight on how you've seen the changes and what future changes are needed, if you don't mind.
Sure. I think we've seen a lot of positive change. We've seen Beth Mowins recently do an NFL game, a Monday night game. And, we see this continually happening. And I'm one of these strange people, I guess, that doesn't think these things should be forced. I think they should happen as they happen. I think we evolve the way we evolve at a pace that is very human. And when I went into this, I had a few role models, certainly. There were people that had done it before I had, certainly Leslie Visser had. But I didn't think of myself as, you know, I'm going off to be a woman in sports. And I think it's important that I didn't think that way. I think it's better to think of, I'm going into a sports career, and I'm not going to have a chip on my shoulder because maybe I'm in the minority right now, and I'm not going to think that I can't do it. I'm certain that I worked a lot harder than most people did, and part of that was because I was a woman and I needed to. But I didn't hold a grudge about that, and I guess I just never allowed it to define me. I decided I was going to let my work ethic define me, my preparation, my ability to adapt and learn, and let those things really define who I was. It's funny, I remember talking to Robin Roberts one time, and when we both started, we felt like we shouldn't be made up too much. We shouldn't be, you know, flaunting femininity at all. And I think we felt like we really needed to establish our credibility first. And, certainly the more you watch yourself on television, the more you say, oh, God, please put makeup on me. And so now we're both okay with it. But it's, as far as what's needed, I just think people just need to keep pressing on and being their best at what they do. And I firmly believe the cream rises to the top when people are giving it their best. And I'm not into forcing these things. And I'll give you one more example and then I'll shut up.
Sure.
These people who are saying we need a woman president, so we just need to have a token woman president. What if that woman is not the best qualified person? You still want to just do it so we can say we have a woman president? That doesn't make sense to me. I'm not against having a female president. I want the right person as president. We've got two of them running right now, but I want to make sure we hire the best person. And I think that that's how everyone should look at their job, not, ooh, I'm going to have an advantage because I'm, you know, I happen to be Hispanic. I never wanted to use that as an advantage. I just think you do your best and you'll wind up where you're supposed to be.
You know, I love that. I'm partners with Warren Moon, and we've had discussions. We do a lot of transition services, and we were coaching and training Cam Newton. And one of the most frustrating things with Warren and being his partner is our main objective is with quarterbacks, we were tired of everyone labeling a black quarterback. And It was very difficult because Warren wanted the same thing. He said, I just want him to be a good quarterback or a bad quarterback, a tall quarterback or a short quarterback, you know, strong arm or not. And I think, you know, one of our biggest achievements, Warren and I at our business, is we've really tried to brand that within all the different professional athletes, announcers, other people that we're working with, and that they're just who they are. And I agree with you that we need to hire the best person to be a reporter or the best person to be a quarterback. And I think that change is organic and it has to evolve because I believe, as I wrote in my book, you know, what you resist persists. And sometimes when we try to force things, it creates more of a void shortage and resistance to what we want, instead of the natural progression of, like's happening in the NFL with African-American quarterbacks, that the best quarterbacks are playing quarterback, regardless of color, size, or strength. And I love that. Now, what advice would you give today? Because I know I love, like, the new statistician on ESPN. You know, here's a woman that loves sports, and she said, you know, I wasn't going to ever – she loves the Bills. She goes, I never was going to be able to play for Buffalo, but, you know, I'm so good at math and statistics. I just love the fact that I'm now on TV and I look beautiful talking about fantasy sports because I can analyze and utilize statistics better than anyone. And she is the most qualified person I've seen talking about fantasy because she actually knows the math of it. And she should probably make millions of dollars actually playing FanDuel instead of being on TV if she's smart. What advice would you give to young reporters, not men or women, today, of how to break into a highly competitive field?
Well, I would say watch a lot of people and ask yourself, what is it I don't like or like about this person? Ask yourself which kinds of announcers appeal to you and what is it about that appeals to you? Because I'm not suggesting you should copy them, but you should aspire to be strong at those areas. I always loved Dan Patrick because I thought he was a great writer and he was funny. He wrote funny, and I loved that glibness. And so, you know, I'm not like that, but I remember thinking it's okay to have a little humor in your stuff. I always loved Bob Costas because he was so smooth. I'll never be as smooth as Bob Costas, but I aspire to be, you know. And even when you take all that in, the bottom line is you have to be you. You've got to be natural. And I think it's very easy early on in one's career to try to copy someone you've seen on television or, boy, this person sounds professional and their cadence is like this and maybe my cadence should be like. No. You've got to be you and you've got to be natural. And I think more than ever these days, that natural demeanor is really important. And I would say practice. This doesn't come without hard work. I mean, nothing good in life does. And I think we tend to forget that. And maybe it's because in this day and age, things come a little bit easier. We don't have to go hunt and fish for our food. You know, we go to the grocery store and we pay someone for it. We don't have to sew our own clothes. Someone does that for us. So it's, you know, we have this sort of instant gratification, this very easy way of acquiring. Even research now, you just punch in something in a Google bar and you've got all this stuff that you want. But you've got to remain diligent about working really hard at what you do because the people that make it look easy, like a great golfer, go out and try swinging a golf club like a great golfer. It's not easy, and it only comes with a lot of repetition. When I was a kid, I used to browse through magazines, and I would just read articles or even the advertisements. I'd read them out loud just to practice, you know, reading and out loud and kind of having that speech. And it was a weird thing to do, I'm sure, but I know that I listened to myself critically, and I just kept doing it. So it's this I guess you've got to be persistent and you've got to be dedicated and committed to really working hard at every part of it. Preparation, delivery, self-critique, and it's, you know what, just practice, practice, practice. When I look back at everything Al Michaels has done in his career, it is astonishing. It is astonishing how many different assignments he has done. And, you know, you ask yourself, well, there's a lot of talent there, too, which is what makes Al unique. He is extremely talented, but he's done a ton of work, and everyone has to do it.
Yeah, no doubt. And you're being modest because you've done a tremendous lot. And I love, you know, surround yourself with the right people, the right ideas. I love the practice analogy. I tell people all the time, if you're going to practice anything, practice gratitude. Say thank you before you go to bed and before you wake up, because you, by practice, you make things from the conscious to the subconscious to your unconscious, which is making it part of you. And you have to be yourself with that persistence and practice. And so that's just fabulous advice. You should write my next book for me. So that's right on my alley. Chris, you have any last questions for Michelle before we let her go?
Yeah, I mean, Michelle, we try to keep everything on the positive side here on Thursday Night Tailgate, and I was just curious to get, you know, a thought from you about some of the guys that, you know, you've enjoyed being around and talking with, because they're just so much fun to interview or to talk with.
Yeah, and that's such a good question, because I think, you know, so often we just see the bad stuff and we think, oh, they're all a bunch of thugs or this and that, and that's so far from the truth. You know, I one time we left an interview with Matt Ryan of the Falcons, and I said in our truck on the way home in our little van, I said, he is the most polite quarterback in the NFL. Let's give the politeness awards, and we ranked all the most polite quarterbacks. Matt Ryan is so polite and friendly and giving with his thoughts. He's a great guy. Obviously, Russell Wilson is a really good role model. And in spite of what some people have decided to think about Richard Sherman, I think he's tremendous because of his background and the example he sets of, again, that hard work. His mom would not let him play football until his homework was done, and that was true every single day of his life. You know, he ends up at Stanford. He's a very smart guy, and he can throw a temper tantrum with the best of them, but he is still very smart. He's worldly. He's cerebral. He's interesting to talk to. So I could go on and on. There are plenty of them, and I'm talking from punters to long snappers to offensive linemen to D-backs. They're sprinkled through, and what's been fun, and people can check this out on NBCSports.com, I do two interviews every week for our .com site, and they're both based on – so this week we have Philly at Carolina, so I'll do one with a Philly player and one with a Panthers player, and I'll talk to them about the public service stuff that they're doing, about the charitable work that they do. And I've been blown away by the variety and the – Anquan Boldin has done so much, and he never touts it for himself. It amazes me how giving some of these people are, that they realize that they have a platform and they can give back. And, you know, there are a lot of these guys in the league that are really, truly committed to making a difference. And it's been great fun to learn about that stuff.
Yeah, and that's the stuff that Bob and I, you know, we lament the fact that, you know, the bad news always finds its way to the front page, and the things like you mentioned here with Anquan Boldin and the guys that are doing great stuff in their communities. If it gets anywhere, that's sort of on page 12 in a very small little article that, you know, you really
if it gets there at all, you're right.
Yeah. Well, thank you for pointing that out, because that's some really great stuff. Michelle, and thank you for your time tonight. Thanks for being a part of the show. We can't thank you enough. We hope you'll come back sometime. We'd love to spend some more time with you just talking about your career and getting more of the things that you've learned about the players, because those are the things that we want to make sure that are getting out in the spotlight.
I love that you guys have such a positive bent to this. That is very necessary in today's world. We need more good news, so I applaud you for doing it.
Thank you. Thank you for saying that. Thanks for being a part of the show. Dave, before we let you run, remind our listeners what you've got on your schedule and where they might be able to catch up with you this week.
You know, I'm up in Napa after this Niners game doing an event for the 11-11 wineries an inspirational talk. I do want to thank you and Bob as well to give me a platform with the 12th Man segment to bring on inspirational people like Michelle who can tell these stories that give the 95% story, which is 95% of the people are exceptional human beings in order to become professional athletes or professional sports people in professionals like Michelle. So thank you so much. I still got San Diego State and Long Beach on my chart for the next week. Speaking around the country, trying to empower others to be happy. The Meltzer Mission is taking off, the Gratitude Challenge. You guys have been terrific in giving me a platform with millions of people in Armed Forces radio network, the iHeart Radio network, and the litany of different networks that we're exposed to. So thank you both. I'm just grateful, as always, to be a part of your Hall of Fame, and you guys are in the Dave Meltzer Hall of Fame, so thank you.
I appreciate that very much. Dave, Michelle, thanks for being a part of the show. We look forward to catching up with you both again, hopefully real soon. Dave, we'll catch up with you again next week. And between now and then, all the best to you and your families.
Thank you. Have a great night, you guys. Take care.
All right.
Good night.
Take care, Dave. David Meltzer, Michelle Tafoya. Boy, Bob, I'll tell you what, that's great stuff. And I can't thank Michelle enough for coming on the show and being willing to share, you know, the great news stories, because, you know, that's just something that we feel never gets enough airplay, or all the good things that guys like Anquan Boldin and many of the rest of the guys around the league are actually doing really good stuff in their communities. And like we like to say, when we have the opportunity to do in our Thursday night tailgate spotlight on the positive.
A great point, Chris, and we have to make it a point to get her on for a full segment, because she really, we can't get it across to our listeners just in that little 10-15 minute segment how one of the great forerunners in the business that she really was. She mentioned Leslie Visser, and I remember I was talking to a guy about Phyllis George this week. These were the people, including Michelle, that paved the way for a lot of the females you see on TV now. A lot of them have nowhere near the talent that some of those early ones did, because think about what they had to put up with, Chris, and to stay on top like they've done. And Michelle's one of the best in the business, and it's just such a pleasure. I've always respected, and she probably should go into the vitamin business too, because she looks just as good now as she did 30 years ago. So just a great guest. We'll have to talk to her down the road, Chris, about her entire career. It's fascinating how many events that she's covered, like you said.
Right. Yeah, look forward to that. All right, folks, we're going to get to our next guest, Tony Collins, and our five-star picks of the week on the other side of this station identification.
Hey, guys, this is Dr. Jen Welter of the Texas Revolution and Team USA, and you're listening to Thursday Night Tailgate with my good friends, Chris Mascaro and Bob Lazzari on the Armed Forces Radio Network.
Now back with us on the Kyven Foods guest line in his weekly time slot is former Patriots Pro Bowl running back Tony Collins and our five-star picks of the week. Tony, how are you feeling tonight, my friend?
Chris, Tony. Bob, how you guys doing?
Oh, fantastic. Right, thank you. How are you, Tony?
I'm doing fantastic.
There you go.
Good.
Well, Tony, you and I bested Bob this past weekend by one game. We were both 4-1. Bob finished 3-2. So, you know, we're making our way back up and making this thing a race again. So you unfortunately bet against my Steelers, which I hope you learned a valuable lesson from. I got burned by the Giants in the NFC East division that I simply can't figure out. And Bob got burned by both the Giants and the Cardinals. So 4-1 for you and me, Bob, 3-2 overall on the season. Bob still leads us. He is 14-6. You and I are 13-7. So we're right there nipping on his heels, my friend.
Yeah, we're close.
That's right. All right, our first game this week is the 2-4 Seahawks going to the 2-4 49ers. The Seahawks are a 6.5-point road favorite. Over-under in this one is 42.5. Tony, who do you like?
And that's really hard to even say, Seahawks 2-4, you know?
Mm-hmm. Yes.
It's just incredible how they've had the lead in a lot of the games they've lost. And, man, it's a tough one. But, you know, I see Seattle coming out on top on this one simply because I think Seattle's defense is going to rise to the occasion this week and do their job. So I'm taking Seattle What a tight game. I'm seeing 24-20 Seattle.
24-20 Seattle. All right. Bob, what about you?
I agree with Tony, Chris. They're Seattle coming off a loss. It's hard to imagine that these two teams are tied with each other. 49ers just can't score, Chris. And I just think Seattle, again, coming off a loss like they did. You know, San Francisco, it seems like they're in disarray. That Kaepernick, you know, unless he's surrounded by a bunch of great players, Chris, I don't think he's worth the money they're paying him. He's got a huge contract, as you know. But I agree with Tony, it's probably going to be pretty close, but Seattle's not going to lose two in a row, not to this team. We're talking Seattle, I'll say 27-17.
All right, Seattle 27-17. All right. Well, fellas, guys, you know the Seahawks are, you know, are they're one team playing at home, but a very different team when they're on the road. 2-1 this year at home, 0-3 on the road, and those three losses this year are to the Rams, Packers, and the Bengals. So some pretty good teams having some good years, but you know, these aren't the 49ers of our youth either. You know, they've lost four in a row, getting a win. You know, only against a pretty bad Ravens team, you know, this past week. So, you know, if you're a 49ers fan, you got to be a little encouraged by what you've seen from Colin Kaepernick. He threw for 349 yards and a couple of touchdowns. Anquan Boldin and Torrey Smith combined for nearly 200 receiving yards and a touchdown, you know. But I'll tell you what perplexes me about the 49ers when you're looking over their stats, guys, where's Vernon Davis? Where's he gone? I mean, one target last week, only 8 receptions so far this season. That actually, you know, has got me scratching my head, because he's such a valuable part, has been such a valuable part of their offense. It's almost completely disappeared at this point. And, you know, meanwhile, on the opposite side, no one has been sacked more times this season than Russell Wilson, if you can imagine that. 26 times he's gone down so far this year, 4 times last week against the Panthers. So that, you know, if you do the math, I mean, he's on pace to get sacked 69 times this season. And San Francisco, by the way, is tied for third in the league with 52 sacks. So, you know, their defense isn't horrible, but you know, Seattle, I just don't know how much punishment, you know, Russell Wilson is going to be able to take. And, you know, you look at Marshawn Lynch. He came back last week, carried the ball 17 times, but for only 54 yards, 3.2 yards a carry for him. So, and this season, he's only averaging, it's a career low, 3.3 yards per carry. So it isn't beast mode any longer in Seattle. So when you look at kind of the sum total of all of that, I don't think it's a stretch to think that, you know, to your point, Tony, I think it's going to be a close game. Now, I'm going to take Seattle to win this one, because I don't think San Francisco is very good. And the fact that they beat the Ravens, you know, who are 1-5, which is embarrassing to me because their one is against my Steelers. But I think Seattle wins this game. I'm right there with you, Tony. I have 24-20 written down just like you do. But it wouldn't shock me, fellas, I guess is what I'm trying to say, if the 49ers actually pulled off this upset. That's how bad I think Seattle is going. But we all three take Seattle.
Why don't you take the 49ers then?
I'm not that crazy. I'm telling you. I think it's going to be close like you do. But, you know, if at the end of the day they ended up winning, I wouldn't be like, you know, wow, I can't believe they won. But I'll go with Seattle. So easy there. Our second game this week are the 2-4 Saints. A lot of 2-4 teams at the 3-2 Colts. The Colts are a 4.5-point home favorite. The over/under is way up there at 52. Tony, who do you like here?
I watched the Saints play Atlanta last week, and just, it was just something about Drew Brees. I think he's back on target. I think he's healthy again. The Indianapolis Colts, man, I don't know. They don't have. You know, you would think with Andre Johnson and the receivers that they have and the tight ends that they have, they would do something. But I just confusing. And then, you know, I don't know if you guys watched the game, the trick play they had.
Yes. <Yeah. laughs> That was tricky. All right.
I guess everybody's seen that though, but. Yeah, I'm going with New Orleans. I think New Orleans is going to get on a little win streak here. New Orleans has a good, pretty good defense right now, and Drew Brees is back on track. So I'm going with New Orleans, and I think it's gonna be. I think it's not gonna be close. I think it's gonna be like 34-20.
34-20. All right. Wow, they blow out the Colts at home. Bob, what do you think?
Boy, this is a tough one. Again, Tony and I flip coins a lot. I think I might do on this one. You know, they're both bad defensively, guys. It's one of those games where probably both quarterbacks are going to probably throw for 300 yards. You know, the Colts coming off a loss and going back home, and the Saints haven't won a game on the road. I'm going to give a slight edge to the Colts, Tony. I'm going to go against Tony. I'm going to say the Colts win this one. How about 30-24, Chris? Colts.
All right. Now, you know, to me, when I look over the stats, guys, you know, Saints defense came alive last Sunday against the Falcons just in time really to keep their dim playoff hopes still alive. Five sacks against Matt Ryan, who had only been sacked 9 times in their previous 5 games. So they were able to get some pressure on Ryan. Tight end Ben Watson had a breakout game. Goodness knows, I cut him from my fantasy team, Tony, right after I played you when he had nothing. And he comes up with 10 catches for 127 yards and a touchdown, making me regret that move. Mark Ingram, a couple of touchdowns, despite only, you know, rushing for 46 yards on 20 carries, but he scores twice. So, and then, you know, speaking of breakouts, you know, I keep waiting for our friend C.J. Spiller, who joined us earlier this year, to have a breakout game. He had that 180-yard, you know, catch and run to win the game for the Saints in overtime a few weeks ago, and which killed me. Speaking of fantasy football, Jim Everett has him on his fantasy football team, and that play alone sunk me in my game against Jim. But outside of CJ, you know, that game, I mean, he's only seen the ball 6 or 7 times a game, which, you know, when you talk about head scratchers, you wonder, why did you bring him in there if you're really not going to give him the ball all that much? Now, the downside, fellas, you know, both sides, you know, their overall record is, you know, we all know how much better the Saints, like Seattle, play at home. The Saints are 0-3 on the road this year. The Colts, on the other hand, played better than I think we all expected last Sunday night. Tony, Bob and I talked about this at the top of the show. We were all expecting your Patriots to blow out the Colts. And it was, you know, it was outside of that ridiculous play that you talked about a moment ago, that fake punt. That was a pretty close game. So, you know, Luck looked good, 3 touchdowns. They're averaging, you know, 5.5 yards a carry on the ground. They were, you know, the other night, and their defense is tied for 10th in the league with 16 interceptions. And they lead the league, by the way, fellas. The Colts defense leads the league with 24 forced fumbles. So there's some life on the defensive side for both teams. But, you know, I'm with you, Bob. I got to go to the Colts at home. I think they assert themselves and get back, you know, and make some distance between themselves and everybody else in the AFC South division. So I'm going to take the Colts and the over, and I'm going to stay very close to, you know, some of your scores, guys. I'm going to take the Colts 34-24. A game 3, fellas. My Steelers, 4-2. Tony, learn a lesson now. My Steelers go to the 1-5 Chiefs. The Steelers are a 2.5-point road favorite. The over-under, fellas, is off the board at this point. And the only way I can figure out why it's off the board is if they're still waiting to see, you know, there's been some inkling, could Ben Roethlisberger come back and play? I don't think that's going to happen. I think it is going to be last week's sort of savior, if you will, Landry Jones, to get the start in this one. So I think they must be scratching their heads trying to figure out what the over-under should be. That's why it's off the board at this point. But, Tony, did you learn your lesson about picking against my boys?
Well, I mean, where does Landry Jones guy come from? I mean, he comes in with those 2 touchdown passes. I mean, I didn't even know he was even on the team. But, you know, Pittsburgh is kind of – they have a great rushing attack, no question about it. And I think with Landry Jones coming in now, playing the way he played it. Now, again, you know, he came in – and, you know, what, second half, whatever time he came in. I can't remember when he came in the game. I don't know, Michael Vick, as much as I love Michael Vick, I think his years at playing in the NFL could be probably over with right now. So I'm going with Pittsburgh simply because they're playing Kansas City. Now, if Roethlisberger was in the game, I would there would be no doubt. But I just don't know about Landry Jones. I mean, you know, it's going to probably be his first start of his NFL career. I don't know, but I'm gonna go with Pittsburgh simply because of the rushing attack that Pittsburgh has, and Kansas City is not really a good team. They're not really playing well. They're losing their top runners out of the game for the year. So I don't know. I think they did complete a touchdown pass to a receiver this year, right?
Yeah, they got off the Schneid.
But, yeah, I'm going Pittsburgh over Kansas City, and I don't think it's going to be close. I'm going 28-7.
Wow, 28-7. Tony loves the blowouts. Bob, what do you think?
You know, the Steelers, Chris, your team, you know, when I pick against them, I pay for it. When I pick with them, I pay for it. It's all about timing. They're a tough team to figure. Kansas City is a shock to me, guys. Five losses in a row. Their season's basically over when you think about it. I mean, it's crazy to say we're approaching Halloween and they haven't won a game at home yet. And I just think, you know, Pittsburgh, just to keep pace with Cincy, is going to be up. They have a better defense. And I think this totally buries Kansas City when Pittsburgh goes in there and wins this week, guys. Yeah, I'm with Tony. I'm going to say Pittsburgh, whoever quarterbacks them, they're still going to win a little closer, 28-20, Pittsburgh.
28-20. All right, well, you know, God bless you guys both giving us 28 points. I appreciate you. So, yeah. You know, and I love – what Landry Jones did last week, 8 out of 12, 168 yards, a couple of touchdowns. Having Martavis Bryant back made a huge difference. Anytime you can throw in a wide receiver at 6'4", you know, it makes things a little bit easier. You know, and Bryant had 137 of the 168 yards, oh, by the way, and both touchdowns from Landry Jones. So, you know, having that size and a guy like that, you know, particularly when you're in the red zone, certainly makes the job easier where you can throw the ball up and he can go get it for you. But, you know, the thing that I've been very happy about, pleasantly surprised, by the way, is the Steelers defense is playing much better than I certainly expected them to play, you know, particularly over the last several weeks. You know, their rushing defense is seventh in the league. They're only giving up a little over 93 yards rushing per week, you know. Where they are weak now, unfortunately, is in the pass defense. They're 26th in the league against the pass. Carson Palmer threw for 421 yards last week against them, but had a couple of picks, one in the end zone, which really, you know, ended the Cardinals' hopes. John Brown had nearly 200 yards receiving in that game. But, you know, if you're going to beat the Steelers, you're going to have to pass the ball, which remains the way to do it. I'm not sure Alex Smith is the guy who can do it as a 24th-rated passer in the league, but he is 11th in passing yards, only, you know, only six touchdowns though, and only one of those, Tony, to a wide receiver. So, you know, Jeremy Maclin being that guy, and as you pointed out, Jamal Charles out, which was really the majority of their offense. So, you know, I'm with you guys. My Steelers go in there, they win again. Landry Jones won't be the second coming of Ben Roethlisberger, and but he will do enough to get the Steelers out of the stadium with a win. I think it's a little lower scoring. I like the Steelers 20-10. All right, game four, fellas. 4-1 Jets go to the 5-0 Patriots. The Patriots are a 9-point home favorite. The over-under is 48. Tony, how badly are the Jets going to win this game?
Nine points? Really? Vegas got
9 points.
Got us for 9 points. Wow. I think this is going to be probably the toughest test for us of the season because of with the Jets defense. Revis and those guys in that defensive secondary are pretty good. They're probably one of the best so far this year. I think Brady is going to be going up against. They got a good defensive line. They got a total all around. They got a good defense. Now their offense, on the other hand, I mean, you know, Ivy rushed for over 100 some yards last week, and you know they got a good rushing attack. The only thing that's, you know, cyclical about them is Fitzpatrick. I mean, he's still playing good football, but, you know, he's, you know, anytime you get a guy, well, he's from Harvard, right?
Harvard? Yeah, Fitzpatrick,
you know, yeah. He's too smart to play football. He should be playing football. At that
Wow. Tony Collins, right there, folks.
I'm just
remember,
kidding.
Write your letters to Tony Collins, all you folks up there at Harvard.
Tony, if he was smart, he would have played 3 years and got out, right?
Yeah. But, yeah, it's going to be a tough game for the Patriots. We got Belichick and we got Brady and we got Gronk. You know, with those combinations and the receivers that we have, we're going to find a way to pull it out. But I think it's going to be a close game. I see it coming down 23-20, us winning it with a field goal.
All right. Bob, what do you think?
I think Tony's right about if New England was going to be picked off, it might be something like this. You have a major rivalry there. I like Todd Bowles as a coach much better than Rex Ryan as far as in the Jets position. You know, he's done it in a very quiet way. His team seemed more focused and more disciplined, maybe not as physical. Rex Ryan was one of these guys that was more of a motivating type thing. Bowles seems to approach these games in a more scholarly fashion, should we say. But and they're amazing. I mean, you know, they're first in rushing offense, and they're very high in both passing defense and rushing defense. Of course, they're going against the juggernaut in the Patriots. So, man, if the Patriots were to get picked off, it would be this week. But I don't think it's going to happen, guys. I think they just want to solidify their spot in that division. Patriots, again, they just throw their helmets out there and put 30 points on the board, and that's what they'll do. They'll win a game, how about 30-21?
All right. You know, look, you know, we've been talking for weeks about how great Tom Brady is playing. Everyone's talking about that. Last week, no different against the Colts, 312 yards, three touchdowns. He did have the one interception. Like Garrett Blunt rushed for nearly 100 yards and a touchdown. Danny Amendola stepped up as Brady's top target last week with seven catches for 105 yards. Gronk and Edelman had their obligatory, you know, touchdown receptions. But like we mentioned earlier, the Colts did have success against them through the air, and Frank Gore did average 6 yards per carry. So the Jets offense, to your point, Bob, running the ball very well, leading the league, 146 yards a game they're rushing for. Chris Ivory is the third leading rusher in the league, you know, based on total yards, but is first in average, you know, yards per game. So the third leading rusher based on total yards, but first in average yards per game with 115. Brandon Marshall adding 102 yards, you know, receiving per game. So the Jets offense has some weapons now this year. Their defense, you guys were saying, second in the league against the run, second against the pass, first in points allowed. So the only downside, you know, if you're looking at the Jets, is Ryan Fitzpatrick, who is tied for fifth most interceptions on the season with seven. If this game was in MetLife Stadium, I would be very tempted to go with the upset, but it's not. It's in Gillette, so it's, you know, Patriots are going to win. But I do think the Jets are going to keep it close, to your point, Tony. They're going to give the Patriots something to think about for when they meet up again. And that game, unfortunately, the second matchup isn't to the second to the last game of the season. But I think it's going to be close. I'm going to take the Patriots 27-21, right on the over-under number as well. So we all agree on the Patriots. Our last game, and then we're going to get to our next guest, Leslie Cord, who's waiting patiently on the line. We're going to get to Leslie in just a moment. Our last game this week, fellas, is the 3-3 Eagles, who are driving me nuts, at the 5-0 Patriots. I mean, Panthers. The Panthers are a 3-point home favorite, the over-under 46.5. Tony, who you got?
Let me tell you, Philly played well against the Giants. Man, it's against the Giants, and you got to put that out there. And I, you know, the Giants are confusing as well, but they played some good ball. They played good ball last week against New York. But, you know, Cam Newton's playing, you know, I'm not saying at MVP level, but he's playing pretty good football right now. They got a good rushing attack, and they got a great defense. They got some great linebackers, good secondary. So I'm going with Carolina. I think Carolina will pull this off, and it may be a close game, but then again, maybe not. Depending on, you know what Philly does offensively. If they get off to a bad start offensively, they could be in a whole lot of trouble with Carolina, because playing catch up with Carolina is not going to be good for them. But so I'm going with that. I'm going to go with Carolina beating them pretty bad. I'm saying 35-14.
Wow. All kinds of blowouts this week on Tony Collins' scorecard. Bob, what do you think?
I like Carolina at home, too, like Tony. They're one of the better defenses in the league, Chris. You know, Cam Newton, he has his ups and downs. But I just think they're what's stuck in their craw. They got blown away by the Eagles last year. That was a pretty nasty loss by Carolina. So I think that's on their minds. I think they want a little revenge. And the last time they went undefeated, and the last time they won their first seven games, I think they went to the Super Bowl. And not saying that's going to happen this year, but I think they have enough to get by Philly, who, like you said, Chris, is a Jekyll and Hyde type team. Carolina wins at home, let's say 27-17.
All right. And like I say, I can't figure the Eagles out. They're driving me nuts. They lose three of their first four, and then they blow out the Saints and the Giants. Does that mean they finally put things together this year? I don't know. Maybe. There was a DeMarco Murray sighting last Sunday against the Giants. He had his first 100-yard rushing game of the season against a Giants defense that was, you know, very good against the run. So that has to be very encouraging if you're an Eagles fan. Sam Bradford, on the other hand, threw three interceptions. So he walked off the field very fortunate that they got a win to all of, you know, to both of your points. Carolina, third best rushing offense because Jonathan Stewart just keeps going and going. 78 yards last week, a couple of touchdowns against Seattle. Cam Newton had a passing touchdown and a rushing touchdown. But if you know, if I told you his passer rating, fellas, was below that of Alex Smith, Jay Cutler, Colin Kaepernick, Blake Bortles, and Ryan Fitzpatrick, you know, would that bowl you over? I mean, Cam Newton at the below Cutler, Smith, Kaepernick, Bortles, and Ryan Fitzpatrick, only completing 55.4% of his passes, which is next to last in the league. The only one worse is Ryan Mallett of the Texans, who has given way to Brian Hoyer there. So, you know, how in the world the Carolina Panthers are 5-0? Well, I'll tell you how. They're rushing the ball very well, and their defense is seventh overall, seventh in points allowed, you know, per game. They're just under 19 a game. They're running the ball and playing solid defense, which has led to a 5-0 start. What a concept, right? The best recipe in the NFL has always been run the football, play solid defense, you know, forget about your fancy schmancy passing schemes. If you can run the ball and play good defense, you're going to win games. And that's how Carolina is doing it. And they're going to do it again this week because they're going to beat the Eagles. And it's going to be a close one. I like it 30-27. So that's how you win games in the NFL, right, guys? If you run the ball and you play good defense, guess what? You're going to win most of the time.
That's old school. That's old school football right there.
That's exactly right. Tony, before we let you go, remind our listeners how they can keep track of you on social media.
TonyCollinsProjects.com. Go to my website. You can also hit me up on Facebook, Tony Collins.
There you go. Tony, thank you so much for being a part of the show again this week. We look forward to catching up with you again this time next week.
Thanks, guys. You guys have a great night.
You
take
do the
care,
same.
Tony.
Take care. Tony Collins. Great stuff as always, Bob.
Love him, and you know, I like you said, he's the queen, the king of blowouts, and he just loves those high
everyone's
scores.
Everyone's getting blown out when you got Tony on the show.
Yeah, that's what you get from being a former Patriot. So he's used to blowouts.
That's right. All right, we've got our next guest, Leslie Court, hanging on the line. We're going to get to her on the other side of this station identification.
This is Christine Lisi, and you're listening to Thursday Night Tailgate, where NFL stars go to tell their stories with Chris Mascaro and Bob Lazzari on the Armed Forces Radio Network.
Now back with us on the Kyven Foods guest line is Leslie Court. Leslie joined us a couple of years ago on our Girls Night Out special. She's a reporter now for GridironNow.com. She was previously the co-host of Mark Ryan's opening drive show here in Atlanta on AM 1100, as well as being the producer of the Atlanta Falcons official pregame show on 680 The Fan, and we are very excited to have her back with us tonight on Thursday Night Tailgate. Hey, Leslie, Chris, and Bob, how have you been?
Hi, Leslie.
Been doing great. I think I'm doing a little better than Bob. I heard him discussing the weather at the beginning of the show, and I got to tell you, I went out paddleboarding in between shows today, so not to brag. So I think
you.
I may be doing a little better than you right now.
Yeah, no, well,
you're
you
smart, girl, Les. Yeah, you're very smart. You're staying in that part of the country, we don't have, your intelligence is quite apparent already. And that's why Chris has me as his co-host being up here in New England. I have no idea, but we're going to find out someday.
I moved from warm to warmer by coming
that's
to
right.
South Texas here.
Wow.
So, Leslie, like I say, you're down there in Houston now, and local team, the Texans, are coming off a promising season last year, 9-7 in 2014, Bill O'Brien's first as the Texans head coach. There was hope that, you know, maybe Ryan Mallett could develop into a big-time quarterback, but he's been benched in favor of Brian Hoyer down there. Mallett not seemed to handle that all that well. What are you hearing down there in Houston about the Texans quarterback situation?
It is a debacle at best. Part of the reason is they have so many troubles on the offensive line, and they don't have the receivers that they had in the past. And these are all things that are really coming back on Rick Smith. And as a GM, there were people that Andre Johnson, Chris Myers, people that they wanted to save money by not re-signing, but at the same time, you lost that veteran presence. And
right. That
was the very worst time to do so when you're in the middle of a quarterback controversy. And you're taking away targets from a guy that has the big arm, throw the deep ball, but no one can catch it. They don't have the people to catch it. It's frustrating to watch. And there's a big article today about how Brian Hoyer's passer rating is over 100 for three straight games. But we're talking about little slot passes. We're not talking about a real, true passing game. Now, DeAndre Hopkins was named Offensive Player of the Week this past weekend. But still, that was against the Jaguars. And you're looking – when you've got an offensive line – that is not cutting it, and you're not getting the passes. And on top of that, you don't have the running game that you expected to have.
Right.
It has just been a debacle. Well, what they were counting on doing was hanging on to that big, tough defense that played so well last year that got them to that 9-7. But at the same time, they had problems stopping the run. The first half of the season especially, they got better as the season progressed, but everybody knew all you got to do is run the ball up the middle because the Texans can't stop you. What'd they do?
Right.
They got older and slower. So that's where they are. They got older and slower on defense. They got rid of their top, will be their first Hall of Famer for the franchise, and Andre Johnson. And don't get me wrong, there are times that those type of decisions have to be made, but you also have to look and see what else you have. And if you don't have anything but his understudy in DeAndre Hopkins, who is a good receiver, but he is not able to stand on his own.
Mm-hmm.
He needs help. And drafting a rookie to take the spot of a legend is just not going to get it done in the NFL.
Yeah, not working out, yeah. And, you know, speaking of, you know, drafting, you know, and guys that had high expectations, you know, we talk about Jadeveon Clowney. It's hard to believe to me. He's been in the league for two seasons now, yet only played 9 games, has yet to record, you know, his first sack or have more than 3 tackles in a game. You know, he missed last Sunday's game against Jacksonville, listed as day-to-day. Are the Texans faithful growing a little restless over Jadeveon Clowney now?
Well, with Clowney, the injury, it's mixed, first of all. Last year, there were people that were jumping out saying he's a bust. Well, he had microfracture surgery.
Mm-hmm.
That is something that is very difficult to come back from, and a lot of people have it. Now, granted, the surgery and technology has progressed in such a manner that a lot more people have had it than you even realize. So the success rates are getting better and better, but generally you're looking at a year on the comeback trail. So he's actually earlier than expected, and I really look at holding him out against Jacksonville is almost precautionary. Because everybody is day-to-day in Bill O'Brien's world. If you ask him about an injury, that's exactly right. That's exactly right. It is always day-to-day. If you basically asking him about injuries is pretty pointless. There are specific ones that he does address. For instance, Cecil Shorts will be out against the Dolphins.
Right.
And, you know, that's another one that's been helping out on the offense. And it's just, it's one of those things that's very frustrating, very, very frustrating to watch.
Mm-hmm. Bob, questions for Leslie?
Yes, Leslie, it's a pleasure to speak with you. I was checking out your website earlier in the week, and I was fascinated by your upbringing, much like myself, how supportive your family, especially your parents, were as far as your passion for sports in general. And it just blows my mind that you had four kids in your family and your parents were able to support them so much, Leslie. They must have been traveling so much with kids going in different directions. Just give me an idea what it was like growing up in a family like that, where it was all about sports. Obviously, it was a little bit more about sports since you got to where you are today. But there was just so much support there that you must feel so very privileged to be where you are right now and have your have family to thank for it, for sure.
Oh, I absolutely do. I come from a family that we have, I believe we're up to 8 coaches now. So there's a weekly meeting at my grandmother's house. It's called the Round Table. And I've asked her several times if I could come and video it because it's fascinating to listen to. And she won't allow me to because she doesn't want everyone to see the language or hear the language. So we're all very, very supportive, but also very rough on each other. So it has helped me to check and double check and make sure I know what I'm talking about before I speak. So for my family as a whole, I over prepare, and I am always, always, always careful, hoping not to make a fool of myself or the rest of my family. But as far as growing up in the different sports, there were summers where 2 kids would get in the car with mom, 2 kids would get in the car with dad, and they would trade off and go in different directions. So both of my parents actually coached in our summer leagues. So it was quite interesting, and I am not certain how they did that at all, but my mother came from a family of 12 kids, so seemed like nothing, I'm sure.
Wow, 12 kids. God bless her.
That is some upbringing. And earlier in the show, Leslie, we're talking to Michelle Tafoya, who Chris and I agreed was one of the forerunners in the profession for women. And I was just wondering if there was any specific women you followed in the business when you were much younger, or were you one of those people that just followed just good journalists and say, that's what I want to be like?
A little of both. And honestly, I came into this business a little backwards from most people. Most people go from doing what I do now into PR. I came from PR. So I have a little different background than a lot of people. So I was doing the media coaching and dealing with journalists from the opposite side of the mic. And that really helps me to get to know what to do, what not to do, and really pick up things and learn something from each person, whether good, bad, indifferent. Michelle Tafoya is a great, great role model for not just females, for anyone aspiring to come into this business. For me in Atlanta, Sandra Golden was somebody that I had the pleasure of working with at CSS, who was always very open to giving advice and really being very supportive. So I was lucky to have somebody who had been in the business a very long time as I was first breaking in. And it's difficult. It is it's a constant struggle, as it is for anyone. And I really agree with what Michelle said about being the best person for the job. Not necessarily, I don't want to be picked because I'm a female. I don't want to be excluded because I'm a female either. I just want to be the best person for the job.
And Leslie, one more before we let you go. You worked alongside another Thursday Night Tailgate alum, Brian Finneran, when you were here. What are some of your favorite stories about our boy Finn?
Well, I will say in my producing days, he is the only person I've had to use the dumb button on.
Is that right?
This is true. He was, I was his very first producer, actually, because that was his first year out of the NFL, and he would tell us every week, I may not be here next week, because he was still going to practices and working out for people, and he said, hope I don't see you next week, hope I don't see you next week, but he is the one and only person I've ever had to use the dump button on.
Wow. That's great.
Leslie, before we let you go. Wonderful person.
Yes. Before we let you go, let our listeners know how they can follow you both online and over social media.
Social media, you can follow me on Instagram and Twitter at LK_comm. I also have a Facebook page, Leslie Court Sports, and you can follow gridironnow.com. Both on Twitter and the website, of course, at Gridiron Now on Twitter and gridironnow.com.
Great stuff. Leslie, thank you for coming back on the show and joining us tonight. It's a delight having you as part of Thursday Night Tailgate tonight. We hope you come back soon. Give us an update on all the great things that you're doing and working on, and let us know how things are going down for the Houston Texans.
I will definitely do that. It's always a pleasure.
All right. Thank you, Leslie. All the best to you and your family. We'll catch up soon.
Thank you.
That's Leslie Court, again, from gridironnow.com. Great stuff, Bob. You know, it's interesting. It goes from Atlanta to Houston, from one big market in the Heat to another big market in the Heat, but doing some great stuff.
And she stayed south, and that tells me she's a very smart woman. But as we mentioned, indeed. But, it's an honor to speak with, people like Michelle Tafoya and, right. Of course, Leslie.
Right.
That combine, such talent, and they've been good at it for a long time, Chris. And again, we need more time to get into more of their careers. I know she's a big Arkansas person, big Dallas Cowboys fans. Maybe later in the year we can discuss things like that.
There you go. All right, we're going to get to our next guest, Nick Lowry, on the other side of the station identification.
Hi, this is former Rams QB Jim Everett. And you're listening to Thursday Night Tailgate, a.k.a. TNT. And it's explosive in here with my buddies, the hosts, Chris Mascaro and Bob Lazzari. And we're listening to all this on the Armed Forces Radio Network. So take it away, Ben.
That's Jimmy. We had Nick Lowry on the line. Looks like we lost Nick. While we try to get Nick back online, we're going to hear these words from our friends over at Coastal Orthopedics.
Are you suffering from chronic pain in your shoulders, hips, knees, or wrists? Tired of living life with an old injury that just won't go away? If you answered yes to either of these questions, we can help. At Coastal Orthopedics and Sports Medicine, Dr. Candelora and his fine staff of medical professionals will get you back on the road to recovery. Their state-of-the-art facility and attention to detail will ensure you will be enjoying life again and feeling invincible in no time. Since 1991, Dr. Candelora and Coastal Orthopedics have been specializing in joint replacement, arthritis, and osteoporosis care, as well as pediatric and adult general orthopedics. Visit us on the web, www.bone-dr.com, or call our Newport Richey office just north of Tampa at 727-848-1417. Proud sponsors of Mike Ditka's The Gridiron Greats Assistance Fund.
Now back with us, making his sixth appearance with us on the Kyven Foods guest line, is our good friend and former Chiefs and Jets Pro Bowl kicker, Nick Lowry. Let me remind you a little bit about Nick's background. He was born in Munich, Germany, grew up in Washington, D.C., and attended Dartmouth College. He got into both Princeton and Dartmouth, but chose Dartmouth, and we'll find out why in just a moment. He also has his master's from Harvard's Kennedy School of Government, played in the NFL from 1978 to 1996 for the Patriots, Chiefs, and Jets. But it wasn't that easy for him. It's amazing to me to 11 times for a guy who now should be in the Pro Football Hall of Fame.
He was a three-time Pro Bowler, named All-Pro seven times. He ranks 10th all-time in field goals made and 13th in field goals attempted. He's the Chiefs' all-time leader in points scored. Nick received the prestigious Byron Rizzer White Award for the NFL Players from the NFL Players Association in 1993 for all the great work he is doing in the local community. He was elected to the Kansas City Chiefs Hall of Fame in 2009. He established the Nick Lowry Youth Foundation dedicated to helping disadvantaged youth, especially Native Americans. And like we've said every time he has joined us on the show, if Jan Stenerud is in the Hall of Fame, there is no way you can justify not having Nick Lowry in the Pro Football Hall of Fame, a guy who had 235 more points and made 80% of his field goals to Stenerud's 64%. But we are honored that Nick is back with us tonight on Thursday Night Tailgate. Hey, Nick, Chris and Bob, how are you, my friend?
I just never stop realizing how smart you guys are.
There you go. Feel free to spread that rumor around, Nick.
Coming from an Ivy Leaguer, too. Wow.
Yeah, exactly. So, Nick, you're a guy, like we say, focused, you know, on your education. Not knowing if, you know, you would have had an NFL career at all. So, like I said in your intro, why Dartmouth over Princeton?
Well, I was very lucky to go to Potomac School in McLean, Virginia, then St. Albans School, where Neil Bush, W's brother, was on the basketball team with me, and we had probably, I think we had 34 out of the 64 members of our class go to an Ivy League school. Seven went to Dartmouth. I believe seven went to Princeton. I think five went to Harvard, and I think four or five went to Yale, as an example. You know, so we were groomed, if you will, to think that we were fortunate people that were supposed to do good things in the world. And I got into Princeton and Dartmouth, and I remember getting – I've been actually recruited by Charlie Gogolak, who was one of the first soccer-style kickers for the Redskins. And I was very tempted. In fact, I basically decided I'm going to Princeton. And when I went on a tour of Princeton versus the tour at Dartmouth, I just felt that the person that had been such a happy-go-lucky classmate a year ahead of me at St. Albans had turned into this very sober, kind of depressed figure at Princeton as a freshman. And I thought, you know, I don't know if that feels right. And when I went to Dartmouth, there was a great camaraderie. One thing Dartmouth has, not that Princeton doesn't, but there is a real camaraderie at Dartmouth. There's a real sense of alumni family there. And even though it's real cold, I'm not really a winter guy, and I played, I think, let's do the arithmetic, 26 seasons in high school and college and the pros in cold weather climates. You know, I just felt like Dartmouth had that energy, and so I changed my mind, and it wasn't fun the freshman year. It was cold, and it was there was, I think, 10 to 1 men to women. Dartmouth had just gone co-ed, so it was cold enough in other ways. But by my sophomore year, things warmed up, so to speak, and you know, I think either school is a tremendous school. Dartmouth has one of the best, probably the best international studies program, not only the finest language program in the world, the Rassius Method, which was developed by my friend, Professor John Rassius, who all 275,000 people that have been in the Peace Corps in over 50 years have been trained in 43 languages in just 3-4 weeks to spend good enough to speak those languages in completely foreign environments. You know, that's what I love about Dartmouth is its connection to the world. Princeton's an extraordinary school as well. So, you know, it wasn't like I was fortunate to even have that choice in the first place.
And Nick, like we say, you know, you grew up in D.C., you have your master's in government, you're a wonderful speaker, you went to Harvard, and you've actually worked for many, many years to make so many people's lives better, and you've got such a wonderful message for young people as well,
which means you
have more qualifications than our current president to lead the government. So why am I not seeing you run for office?
You know, when I do our leadership training for youth, whether it's Native youth or whether it's, you know, just diverse youth, we've done four trainings in the summers at Dartmouth College with incredibly diverse youth.
The first thing I say pretty much is that we live in a post-governmental era, that we really suffer from the illusion of government. The Citizens United decision by the Supreme Court has rendered traditional leadership that is independent of money almost completely unrecognizable. And while I think that Hillary Clinton and Bill Clinton have a lot of experience, and while I think that there are going to be some people on the Republican side that have things that are, that can add to the quality of life, for the most part, our system doesn't know how to solve the fundamental issues of hope, or shall we say hopelessness, income disparities, poverty. And so it's up to all of us. All of us can do something. Somebody who has a radio show can do what you're doing, which is point the light, point the sound to support things that really are making a difference. And that's the great thing about what we can do as individuals. So I'm not being a politician by saying I love what I do, because I can do this and make a real difference without going through the gauntlet of crap that is politics. I mean, we have a very difficult situation where people can't talk in depth about virtually anything, and Republicans and Democrats don't know how to work together. When I was a legislative aide for Senator John Chafee of Rhode Island, former governor of Rhode Island, a Republican, but a liberal, or if you will, moderate Republican in a liberal state in Rhode Island, or a moderate Republican like Bob Packwood, I would work for a Democrat with backbone or a Republican with backbone and with clear ideas, even if I disagree with them, rather than politicians that, go back and forth. And most importantly, that put solving problems way, way ahead of whether it supports the party. I'm tired of party politics. I want to just solve the problems in this country. And, I think we can do that one person at a time just by inspiring this generation and each of us doing our part.
There you go. And Nick, and you spent time in Washington working with different senators on some very big issues. Tell our audience, talk about the things that you've gone to Washington to try to bring attention to.
This is so cool that you guys are asking. Well, the first thing I did was I worked on Carter's energy plan as an intern for Senator Chafee. And even today, when I fly into Phoenix, it's really hard for me to see all these rooftops, with 330 days of sun a year and yet almost no solar paneling. It's more than we used to have, but it's far less than we should have. So, there it was, 1976, 77, working on Carter's energy plan and looking at OPEC and the embargo and the long lines of the gas stations, for those that are old enough to remember that or read enough to know that. And, our dependency has been reduced by some of the fracking and the amazing oil deposits in North Dakota. There have been some negative things from that, but it's given us some independence. But I worked on that. Then I worked on aviation safety and the Olympic boycott for Senator Bob Packwood. And that was going to be my job, guys. I was going to work on the staff, the minority staff of the Senate Commerce, Science, and Transportation Committee. And I did that. And then I got this call from the Kansas City Chiefs, who offered me a whopping $2,500, which no one else had offered. And I just thought it was a sign that I should try that one last time. They were going to bring me in in May to train way before training camp. And it's a great lesson that if you stick with things really diligently for 2 years, you can totally transform your self-confidence. And I was a very different kicker than I was when I started with the Patriots in 78, when I was there competing against Jan Stenner in 1980. And then in my first off-season, working after I made it with the Chiefs, I worked for Richard Bowling, who is chairman of the House Rules Committee, looking at the history of government and structures of government, which was interesting. And he'd been a congressman for 32 years, and every week, for at least once a week, he'd sit me down in his office for 2 hours and give me essentially a lecture on the history of government. And then the next year I worked for Tom Eagleton, looking again at the rise of Roosevelt in 1932 during the Great Depression, when he was elected, versus the rise of Reagan in 82. And those were all just incredible references for me. And the next year was Elizabeth Dole. And I looked at it, guys, that when you are in the NFL, you're so tempted to think that you're all that and more. And when you go back and you have to work on real life issues, it keeps you a little bit more grounded. And I got to work for Elizabeth Dole on shipping deregulation, and All those references in 88, I worked in the Drug Abuse Policy Office for President Reagan, and in 89 for H.W. Bush on the Points of Light Foundation. And then maybe my most exhilarating experience was working for the Clinton White House on the creation of AmeriCorps, which is a domestic peace corps, 75,000, almost 100,000 people every year solving problems across the country. So every single one of those is connected to each one of us can make a difference. And the earlier we give the next generation references to being leaders, to being courageous, to doing great things, not just in the military but in their own communities, everybody, including them, are permanently changed in a positive direction.
That's absolutely amazing stuff, Nick. Kudos to you. And when you kind of read back on all the things that you've worked on and the things you've touched on here tonight, it's amazing stuff. And there's no doubt why you've been recognized so often for being such a great contributor to our communities. Thank you for all of your service.
Thank you for asking. Not everybody asks that question, so I appreciate it.
Bob, questions for Nick?
Nick, it's an honor to speak with you again, and I had the opportunity to talk to Yale head coach Tony Reno the other night. I've been able to talk to him and interview him the last 2 years. He's doing a great job there, and he gave us a real insight, Nick, into that true student-athlete. We hear that term a lot, student-athlete, across the country, but in the Ivy League it means more probably than in any other conference. And We talked, believe it or not, Nick, we ended the interview at 8 o'clock p.m., and he was on his way to the practice field because they had a night practice. They practiced around classes, and they also did have a night game coming up this week. But we talked about how incredibly tough it is for the normal student-athlete at an Ivy League institution. 99% of them are never going to make it to the NFL. We know that, and they play football for the love of it. But we always hear college is the vehicle for kind of budgeting your time, learning how to be a man, learning
exactly.
How to
exactly.
And nobody. It seemed to me that it really resonated when I talked to Tony how he led us into the life of these Ivy Leaguers, and I'm sure you feel exactly the same. It prepared you how to budget your time because these guys are always on doing something.
You know. And for anybody that's listening, the interesting counterintuitive lesson is the more you fill up your time with quality things, the less time you have to screw around, and usually the better the grade you get. Now, there is a turning point where you can overstress yourself, and I'm not advocating that, but there's something that is really important in learning that spending your time where you have no choice but to do valuable things every second of the day, you have less time to get in trouble, less time to get distracted. And the other side of it that I think is really important when you look at Ivy League guys that do make it in the NFL is a lot of them end up having better careers than the average bear, not because they're faster, not because they're bigger, not because they're stronger, not because they're more talented. It's because they know how to work on their weaknesses. They have the discipline. Part of that is time and focus, the ability to focus really diligently, even when they're tired. But it's also just knowing that you only get better with that disciplined hard work on the things you're uncomfortable with. And that's such an important lesson for kids today. And it's the discipline, I think, of your mind, body, working together. And when a coach is looking for somebody to start and he notices a Duron Cherry who didn't go to an Ivy League school but went to Rutgers as an example, or whoever that player is, when that player doesn't make mistakes, or most importantly, they're all going to make mistakes, but they don't repeat mistakes. They seem to learn quickly and have a passion to apply that and not keep repeating. Well, what do you think the coach is going to do? He wants a player that learns quickly, isn't perfect because no one's perfect initially, but is always improving and doesn't repeat mistakes, cares about those things. That's a guy he can depend on, whether it's a quarterback coming in who's a backup quarterback, whether it's a Duron Cherry who was a backup punter for us in 81 and just seemed to make good tackles and not make a lot of mistakes on special teams. And then 2 years later, he began a string of six straight Pro Bowls. And Duron was not fast. Duron was not that strong, but he was sharp. He was a great leader. And I think that's a good analogy for Ivy League players in general. Reggie Williams being another great example. My teammate at Dartmouth, 13 years, he was a he was a man-child. He just destroyed people on the field in the Ivy League. But he always worked to get better. There was a lack of complacency, and that's something you learn. I learned it a really good, solid way, which is getting my rear end rejected 11 times before I made it. So that was a good teacher, too.
And what were your – I probably asked you this the last time, Nick. What were your expectations coming out of Dartmouth? Did you have feelers that there were NFL teams interested, or you said, well, I have the education to fall back. Let's go out and look for some work.
You know, I knew I had a chance, but that's about it. You know, I had a dream and I had a chance. It would have been, frankly, probably a little bit easier if I'd gone to Princeton for the reason that the New York Times covers Princeton football more. I probably would have gotten more exposure. But I had a couple game-winning field goals. Did not have a great senior year. I had a fantastic junior year. But all of that was that transition, learning how to have the guts to confront that fearful thing called your dream, because it is fearful when it's real, for the very reason that when you confront your dream, there's a chance you might lose it. And a lot of people don't realize that until they actually take it on. And so I got cut, and I thought that might be the end of the world. But then I realized I just have to keep going. I have to keep sawing wood. I have to keep learning. And 2 years later, I was so much tougher, so much more aware, so much physically stronger, but emotionally too. The funny journey I think that you go on, especially when you've been way out of that loop as an Ivy League player, I found myself thinking I had to be somebody else. And then the more rejections I went through, and yet the more, conversely, improvement I went through, I noticed it was really about being more myself, more at peace with myself and my preparation, and not worrying about not, you know, feeling like an imposter. And the only way you learn that in anything in life is putting yourself out there over and over and over again. And there's a great beauty in liking that uneven process, but it's really what life's about.
That's great stuff. Nick, let our listeners know, before we let you go, how can they follow you both online and over social media? You're great.
Well, I thought you guys were going to talk about our Chiefs a little bit, but I'll tell you what, let me just tell you one thing. I'm very excited. It looks like we're going to be doing a fundraiser here coinciding with, and it's not definite yet, but it's close to it, so I'm going to mention it anyway, with Will Smith's movie Concussion. And I've been working on that. I have a lot of friends that have, courageous, long-term NFL players who have suffered the effects of this, and we don't want to focus on blame. We want to focus on reducing the effects of it and reducing the impact for future players. And so we're going to have an event here in December. But my foundation website is nicklowry.org, N-I-C-K-L-O-W-E-R-Y, nicklowry.org. And there's a donate button there, and that you can email me, and I'll send you information about what we do. We do anti-bullying programs, which is, you know, connected to all this, because it's all about empathy. And as athletes, right, that's a really important thing, too.
Yeah, no, that's great stuff, and that's always very near and dear to our hearts. Nick, we'd love to have you back on just as quickly as we possibly can, because we would like to get into getting your thoughts about the Chiefs and learn more about your involvement with Concussion. Unfortunately, just didn't have enough time to get into everything tonight,
no problem, guys.
There's another side of what you do that people would be interested to know about, and I wanted the opportunity for you to talk about
it. I appreciate it. Well, thank you, guys. Welcome. Really do.
All right, take care, Nick. We'll catch up with you again real soon.
Have a good night.
All right, you too.
Good night.
Take care. Bless you.
What a great man. All the great stuff, Bob, that he has done and he does for communities, you know, everywhere. So can't thank Nick enough, but we got to get him back on to talk a little more Chiefs, and then talk about his involvement with Concussion, because that's going to be an unbelievable movie.
Hey, such a fascinating man with a fascinating life. The scope of his life is, and it just seemed like the time just went by so quick with him, Chris. And
right.
Did you get the idea we were talking with an Ivy Leaguer there?
Yeah, absolutely. Huh?
Slightly?
Yeah.
Yeah, he was something. And, he's the type of guy you have to have on a couple times a year. Once for all the – I'm blown away by what he's done in politics and everything, and how he's against politics in a way, but we can get into more of that. But I agree with you, Lee. He should definitely be in the Hall of Fame, Chris. It's a no-brainer. I'm looking at his stats right now, and you compared him to a Hall of Famer already, but the guy was so solid for so long. It's crazy.
Yeah, that's exactly right. All right, now joining us on the Kyven Foods guest line is Hall of Fame defensive back Lem Barney. Let me remind you about Lem's background. He's from Gulfport, Mississippi, played his college ball at Jackson State, where he was a three-time All-Southwestern Conference player. In his junior and senior seasons, he combined to intercept 20 passes, plus he did double time as the team's punter, averaging 41.7 and 42.5 yards per punt. In 2011, he was inducted into the Southwestern Athletic Conference Hall of Fame, joining our recent guest, Ken Houston, who was also inducted back in 2013. Lem was a second-round draft pick in 1967 by the Detroit Lions. He was the 1967 Rookie of the Year, leading the NFL in interceptions with 10, three of which he returned for touchdowns. Played in the NFL from 1967 to 1977, all with the Lions. Was a seven-time Pro Bowl selection. Over the course of his career, he had 56 interceptions, seven of which he returned for touchdowns. Also had 25 fumble recoveries. He also had 1,312 punt return yards, 1,274 kick return yards, and pulled double duty in the NFL with the Lions as their punter in 67 and 69. Was a member of the NFL's all-decade team for the 1960s and was inducted into the Pro Football Hall of Fame in 1992, becoming only the fifth cornerback to be inducted into the Hall. And we are very honored that he is with us tonight on Thursday Night Tailgate. Hi, Lem. Chris Mascaro and Bob Luzzeri here. Thank you for joining us.
Chris and Bob, thank you so very much for having me on your show. I was getting tired as you kept making those statistic remarks. That was a lot.
It was a lot.
Long career.
That's why you're in the Pro Football Hall of Fame.
Yes, thank you. Thank you.
Great.
Lem, I want to start with your time at Jackson State. You know, you guys, you know, have some very talented NFL alumni who went to school there. Guys like, you know, you and Walter Payton, Jackie Slater, Harold Jackson, who's the coach now, Robert Brazil, Coy Bacon, just to name a few. Tell our listeners about the rich football tradition you guys have at Jackson State.
Yes, it really was a rich tradition, as you mentioned. I was scouted by some other colleges. Eddie Robinson from down at Grambling, even Alcorn State University, tried to get me, Mississippi Valley State University, and a couple of teams in Alabama. But for my mom and dad, I made the choice to go to Jackson because Gulfport is not as far away as those other colleges were as it was from Gulfport, Mississippi, to Jackson State. And so I chose Jackson State, and merely because of the fact of the matter, the great Willie Richardson, who played for Jackson State as a wide receiver and went to the Baltimore Colts and played with Raymond Berry and caught a lot of passes from Johnny Unitas, was an icon for me while I was in high school. So I chose Jackson State, and I think it was the best choice that I could have made because the fact of the matter, I had a great opportunity. I didn't play my first year. I went in as a quarterback as well. Not as a defensive back, but I played defensive back and quarterback at 33rd Avenue High School in Gulfport, Mississippi. And getting up there, they had two great quarterbacks who were juniors my freshman year. And one of them happened to be the athletic director's son. And the other one was the starting quarterback. They called him Shotgun because he had an arm when he threw it. You could tell it was coming if he was in bump and run. You could hear the velocity because he threw it so hard. So wow. I ended up being like the fourth team quarterback my freshman year and didn't get a chance to play at all. And I ended up my freshman year going down on punt coverage and kickoff coverage. And I asked coach during the spring ball of my sophomore year if I could have a shot at playing defensive back. And he said, "Oh, Barney, you're not going to hit anybody." I said, "Coach, he didn't give me a chance to show you even on special teams." He said, "Well, okay." And the first game, my sophomore year, they started me at the corner, and we played against Fort Benning, the Doughboys from Fort Benning. And I picked off three and ran one back for a touchdown, and the rest of it is history for me at Jackson State. Cornerback was my position.
There you go. And, you know, as I rattled off some of the names, Lem, of the guys that, you know, that were there at played at Jackson State, did you ever have an opportunity? Did you guys ever get back together as a group? Because, you know, I mean, all the names I rattled off, again, Payton and Jackie Slater and Harold Jackson, Robert Brazil, Coy Beck, great players that went
Speedy
on to
Duncan,
have great NFL
Richardson, Thomas Richardson, Eddie Payton, Walter Payton's brother as well. Yes, sir. We had quite a few. Roy Curry was a quarterback for Willie Richardson during the years, and yeah, we've had some back to college reunions and going down, particularly during homecoming, and we'll unite together and stay there for about 3 to 4 days before the game and have a good time.
Yeah, that's got to be great. It's a boy to be a fly on the wall when you guys were talking.
Absolutely.
You know, and Lem, as a kid who grew up, you know, in Mississippi, you know, at a time when, you know, the Saints were the only team in the southeastern part of the country because the Falcons and the Dolphins didn't even exist before 1966. I'm curious, who'd you grow up rooting for?
Well, I grew up rooting for Baltimore. I like Johnny Unitas merely because I was a quarterback in high school. I had 1 year of my junior year. My ninth grade in middle school, I went to Sturgis Junior High in San Bernardino, California. My mom's youngest sister lived out, and she came to Gulfport to visit mom during the summer and said, well, you ought to come up to Sturgis. You can play football. And my mom really didn't want me to play football at all. She wanted me to stay in the band and stay in the choir and do those type things because I was the only surviving son. But my auntie coerced me to go out to Sturgis, and I played. And it was a great lesson. I had the chance to mix with some various ethnicities, which wasn't popular down in Mississippi during those years. So it was a great training camp for me, and I truly enjoyed it.
Bob, questions for Lem?
Yeah, Lem, it's a pleasure. And I also noticed 33rd Avenue High School, Jerome Barkham was a graduate from that school, and he, of course, was a first-round pick of the Jets back in the 70s. He came into the league, Lem, probably halfway through your career, but having gone to the same high school, and he went to Jackson State, I believe, also.
He did.
I'm sure your paths crossed, and I was just wondering how close you guys were back in the day.
Very close. In fact, Jerome's brother was a running back during my tenure at 33rd Avenue High School in Gulfport. His name was Elliot Barkham, and he went to Alcorn, and he played at Alcorn State, and he just didn't pursue it. He had the skills to become a great running back, and I still, till today, don't understand why he didn't pursue it. But I think he dropped out his senior year. But Jerome ended up a great player, and went to the Jets and played with Namath and guys like Azat. But Jerome was a fine wide receiver.
He sure was. And you know, when you got to the NFL, Lem, with Detroit, Joe Schmidt was the coach, a Hall of Famer in his own right as a linebacker. And when we hear of coaches and managers a la your Joe Schmidts and Ted Williams, sometimes, Lem, they're perfectionists, and they're in tough positions because a lot of their players will never be as good as they were. How was Joe Schmidt to play under as far as an X's and O's guys, and did you enjoy those few years you had in Detroit under him?
Certainly did. I played my first 7 years in the league under Coach Schmidt, and one of Coach's teammates, who I became a teammate of in 1967, who's a Hall of Famer as well, Dick LeBeau, who's still in ball. He's been in ball all of his life, from the time he was in high school in Ohio, from Ohio State to the Detroit Lions, and from the Detroit Lions to the Pittsburgh Steelers. And he's still involved in football. I think he's going to go to glory in football. But what a great guy number 44 was as a player and still is. But again, Coach Schmidt, a tremendously great head coach, and just a joy to play for. And Coach Schmidt played on the Lions' last championship teams in 53 and 57, along with my defensive coordinator for my first 7 years in the league, the late, great Jimmy David, who played defensive back with Coach Schmidt, along with the great Night Train Lane, who played in the secondary for the Detroit Lions. So, but Joe was a great guy, and I just had a chance to be with Coach just a few days ago as we went down to Ford Field to push the Lions into their first win for the season. We had an alumni thing going on just this last week, and we pulled the Detroit Lions out of the 0-4 season. Now they got one win, and prayerfully they can continue to win.
When we had former Lions and Redskins defensive back Mike Bass on the show with us a couple of weeks ago. Mike spent some time on the Lions taxi squad when you and Dick LeBeau were the starting defensive back. Do you remember playing alongside of Mike?
Oh, absolutely. Absolutely. Mike was a fine defensive back. And, you know, again, he really wanted to play, but we had a house full of guys when Mikey came in, and he ended up switching off going to the Skins. And I think he showed his skills and his talent. He was a fine defensive back as well.
Your quarterback, Greg Landry, joined us a couple of months ago, and you guys played together for several years. I'm curious, what do you remember about playing, you know, against him in practice and then playing with Greg Landry?
Yeah, playing against him in practice. He was a fine quarterback, had a great arm, and he beat out a great guy, Bill Munson, who was the quarterback before Landry came in. And Landry had a stronger arm than Bill, and Landry had some great scrambling skills as well. We had some great times and some big wins with Greg, and saw Greg last week at the game as well, and he's doing fine.
And in 1970, Lem, you guys made the playoffs. You played against the Cowboys, a game you guys lost 5-0 in a sort of pitcher's duel in that playoff game. The Cowboys would go on to play the Colts in Super Bowl V that year. Do you guys ever look back at that playoff game against the Cowboys and really think, you know what, that should have been us in the Super Bowl?
Well, you're going to make me cry again. I really boo-hooed after it. After the loss, and I can't go back and say it's, but I think it is the record-setting playoff game in history, 5-0. I don't think any other playoff game was that lower a scoring.
Uh-huh.
The Cowboys went on to the Super Bowl that year, if memory serves me well.
Right.
And, we had a great unit that year, but we just didn't. Just didn't get it going. Greg didn't have the click that he had during the season. I think the Doomsday Defense, which they was called back in the days, with Bob Lilly and the guys, sort of put a little fright in Greg, and Greg didn't play to his ultimate. He said that on many occasions afterwards. But Bill Munson came in and got our biggest drive of the day. In about 2.5 minutes remaining in the game, and we almost pulled it out, but the victory never came our way as well. But that was the only playoff I had my entire 11-year career.
Mm-hmm. Bob, a couple more for Lem?
Yeah, Lem, and Chris had mentioned the 10 interceptions in your rookie year. Now, I don't know if that's a record for a rookie, but it's got to be close, and it's just incredible how opposing quarterbacks probably looked at and said, we're gonna go after rookie number 20. And obviously you held your ground. And did you find out, Lem, in subsequent years that they tended not to throw your way as much because of such a great rookie year you had?
Well, you know, I had, and I'm blessed to say this, coming first out of Jackson State again before I got to Detroit, I had 26 interceptions in college, and I had a great defensive coordinator named Henry Lattimore, who played defensive back also, that gave me a lot of the insights about playing defensive back. And again, blessed again after being drafted number 2 by the Detroit Lions in 67 and having a coach, Jimmy David, who played defensive back for the Detroit Lions along with coach Joe Schmidt. So I've been blessed in that situation. And picked off 10 passes, as you mentioned, and led the league in 1967, my rookie year. And I can recall it like yesterday, my first league game after we was 2-2 in our preseason game. We went to play the opening game up in Lambeau Field under the direction of the late, great Coach Vince Lombardi and Bart Starr, who was an icon for me in middle school and high school because I played quarterback. And the first pass was the second play of the game, and I intercepted it, and I ran it in for a 27-yard touchdown from Bart Starr. And I said, wow, this is going to be easy. But it wasn't easy. I had to grow into understanding the game. But, I mean, I really enjoyed it. But, yeah, it was great playing the corner and punt return, kickoff return, and punted as well for a number of years.
And you played 8 years, Lemon, in that shrine they called Tiger Stadium. The memories and just the sport memories of various sport figures in that building, I could still remember some great times. And it must have been such a shock to you moving indoors, you know, no more infield dirt, no more, a lot more noise probably. But what were your feelings going from Tiger Stadium into the Silver Dome in 75?
Well, it was as you mentioned, it was a shock. I played in Houston, which was the first dome built where we were playing, and then when Detroit made the Silver Dome their next place of playing, I mean, it was a joy. I mean, it was tough playing on that AstroTurf, but you had to make some adjustments because most of the guys' life they played on grass, and now you're playing on the synthetic turf called AstroTurf, and there's a pad underneath it, and you can get some pretty nasty burns from it. But, I mean, again, it's been a popular thing since the mid-70s, so I think it's going to be ongoing. But it was okay. You have to make the adjustment, so I think we did pretty good with it.
Yeah.
Lem, just a couple more before we let you go. I'm curious, 1992, the phone rings, and it's the Pro Football Hall of Fame calling you to let you know that you were chosen to be inducted. Curious, where were you and what was that like?
Wow. well, I was at home when I got the call, got the nod, and it was a surprise call, and I thought maybe somebody was kidding. And I said, come on, don't do that. And they said, no, it's the truth. You've been selected to be enshrined in Football's Hall of Fame. And we had one of the smallest classes, Al Davis, John Mackey, from the Baltimore Colts, John Riggins, from the Redskins, and myself. And I said, are you kidding me? Are you just playing around? He said, no, it's true. We can send you some information. So it was just unbelievable because, I mean, you know, I thought I maybe had, you know, no Super Bowls, had seven Pro Bowls, but, I mean, you know, one playoff, and I just, you know, I had no idea about the opportunity of becoming a Hall of Famer. And then when I got that nod, I said, wow, it is true. And the first one, I was the first one to go in and make the remarks, and the first thing out of my mouth was, for once in a lifetime, a man knows a moment, one wonderful moment when fate takes his hand, and this is my moment. So I gave a few renditions of For Once in a Lifetime. With no Super Bowls, with no championships or anything, only one playoff, but that gave me the ticket right there, getting inside the Football Hall of Fame.
And I read, is this right? I read that you and Barry Sanders and Joe Smith just received your Hall of Fame rings. Is that right?
Yeah, we got it at a function at the game just this past week where the Lions won for their first victory for the year. Yeah, and John Baker came in from Canton to David Baker. I'm sorry. Yeah, David Baker came in from Canton to present us the Hall of Fame rings, Joe Schmidt and Barry Sanders and myself. And, I mean, you should see it. It's almost like a bracelet. I mean, it's so big.
but 23 years later, right, why did it take so long?
Well, I mean, it's a new one now. I mean, you know, they started with the new rings. And why they did it, I have no idea, but I'm glad. I mean, I still have my old one I wore from being enshrined in 1992, but this one is it's truly an icon. Like I said, you can use it as a bracelet. It's so large.
That's good. Lem, I know you do some keynote speaking and some other events. Do you have any events coming up that our listeners, you know, might be able to attend or catch up with you at?
Well, I don't have any write-off, but, you know, and I'm an associate at my church, associate minister in my church, been in the ministry for 26 years now, and that's one of my joys. Church has always been a number one icon coming up under the direction and the love of Bert Eld and Lim, the great mom and dad combination who fostered me into the world. Church wasn't an option in their home, and so it's been a part of me all of my life. And being a member of the FCA for a lot of years from college into the league, and being a director after being here in the league, and still do some things with the Fellowship of Christian Athletes. So it's just been a joyful life, and the Lord has truly been good to me.
That's fantastic. Lem, thank you so much for taking time out of your night to be a part of the show. It's been an honor for us to have you with us tonight on Thursday Night Tailgate. We hope you'll come back and do it again sometime. I'm sure you got thousands of stories. We'd love to hear more of them.
Yes, sir. Anytime you give me a call, I'll be ready to be right at the mic for you.
Thank you, man.
Appreciate that, Lem.
All right, take care, Lem. All the best to you and your family. We look forward to the opportunity to speak with you again, hopefully real soon.
Thank you very much.
Take care.
All right, bye-bye.
Wow, Bob, you want to talk about an honor right there. What a great, you know, not only a great, you know, playing career that you have, what a great man Lem Barney is.
Chris, do you get that idea? I mean, I don't know if it sounds corny to people that might be listening, but don't you get a different feeling after you've talked to a Hall of Famer? It's kind of
yes.
An eerie feeling. We've had tons of them, and, you know, we've done it before, but you still get that feeling that there's just something special about these guys. He did everything the right way, Chris. 11 years in one town. He, you know, obviously he just off the field, on the field. You could tell he got out at the right time. He got out, Chris, 32 years old, picked off 3 passes, probably could have played more, but knew he wasn't probably the Lem Barney of old, but still probably one of the best in the league. And that's, I guess, what makes a Hall of Famer. But he... Man, 70 years young, Chris, and still as sharp as a tack. And, yeah, we can get into a lot more with him. I hope to speak with him again.
Yeah, definitely. We got to get Lem back on the show as quickly as we can. So many great stories to hopefully get in and an opportunity to talk with him. And you know, a quick shout-out to our good friend Renee Shull at Integrated Play for connecting us with Lem. So we really appreciate Renee. And as we always say on this show, and we haven't had an opportunity to give Renee the proper shout out tonight, so I want to make sure we do that before we close up shop. As you hear us talk about every single week here on Thursday Night Tailgate, Renee Shull at Integrated Play is doing so many great things with some of the former players who have been in job transition from going to being, you know, from being pro athletes and are now getting into the job market. If you are somebody who is in the job market or you're looking to get into a job transition to find something else, you know, please check out Renee Shull at integratedplay.org online and give her a follow at Integrated Play. You know, Renee is somebody who is near and dear to our hearts, has been so good to us and is such a big part of the show, you know, even behind the scenes. So if you want to do business, we all want to do business with somebody that we can trust and who has our best interests at heart. I keep telling you every single week, there isn't somebody that fits that bill any better than Renee Shull at Integrated Play. She's a great person. She is smart. She's talented and the kind of person that you're going to want to work with and have working for you. So please check her out online. Again, integratedplay.org. Give her a follow on Twitter at Integrated Play. You're going to work with her for 2 minutes and you're going to understand why we say what a great person, what a great job Renee does every single week on the show. So please give her a follow again at Integrated Play on Twitter and check her out online, integratedplay.org. All right, my friend Bob, it's time for us to put a bow on this episode. Great night tonight, folks. Thanks to David Meltzer, Michelle Tafoya, Tony Collins, Leslie Court, Nick Lowry, and Lem Barney for being a part of the show and joining us tonight. And Bob, as I say every single week as well, the best part of the whole night is getting the opportunity to spend 2 hours doing this show with you.
Oh, Chris, I mean, when you have great guests like that, again, it's just like talking in the living room, and that's the way we like to have it come across the airwaves. And when you can throw a Hall of Famer here and there, it just makes it all the more special. And my goodness, Nick Lowry, I'm still blown away by half the things he said. I didn't understand half the words he said, Chris. And I had... I have a pretty good education myself, but that's one smart dude. And but hey, you know, it's how we like. We have a great mix of guests on the show, and that's where the props go to you, my friend.
I appreciate that. All right, next week, who do we have set to join us? Well, former Bears defensive back Walt Harris is going to be making a return visit with us on TNT. Former Lions offensive lineman Mike Utley will be making his TNT debut. Look forward to the opportunity to speak with Mike. Our good friend and former Raiders quarterback and Thursday Night Tailgate Hall of Famer Rusty Hilger will be back. Plus, you know, Tony Collins is going to be here for our five-star picks of the week. And, of course, David Meltzer as well in our 12th man segment. So another really great show on tap for you next week, folks. We hope you'll come back and be a part of it with us. Want to remind you how you can follow us on social media. On Twitter, I am at CT Mascaro. Bob is at Bob_Lazzari. And the show is at TNT Podcast. Plus, please check out our Thursday Night Tailgate page on Facebook. Give us a like. That's important to us, too. Plus, you can stay up to date with who some of our future guests are going to be. And you can stream or download any of our archive episodes for free, folks, by going to our website, ThursdayNightTailgate.com. Bob, take us home, my friend.
All right, sir. We'll talk next week. Our thanks, of course, to our announcer, Joe LaGenusa, for the great job he does with our weekly intro and ads. And to Kyle Turley, Tim Pickett, and all our friends over at Gridiron Records for their partnership and our upcoming outro music. On behalf of myself and Chris, we thank everyone out there tonight for listening. We appreciate you all the most. Until next week, good night, Kevin. Keep fighting.